Good morning, everyone. Hope you've had a great week. What a wonderful day to be in God's house. Amen. Welcome again to our fellowship here at New Home Baptist Church. Today we have come to receive weekly encouragement. And through our message later on, we'll hear how not only can we receive encouragement from each other, but we should be that encouragement. So today we've come to receive weekly encouragement from the love of God, from the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and also from the communion of the Holy Spirit. And you may say, well, what does that mean, communion of the Holy Spirit? Well, whether you realize it or not, whether you believe it, I hope that you do, the Holy Spirit is always around us, working within us, working through us, and many times, as you'll hear me say, working in spite of us. So we should also desire to share that same encouragement with others from being in this place today. We call this today our filling station. I've got a couple of scripture verses that I want to read to you from Psalms 31. I will praise the Lord at all times. I will constantly speak his praises. I will boast only in the Lord. Let all who are helpless take heart. Come and let us tell of the Lord's greatness. Let us exalt his name together. I prayed to the Lord and he answered me. He freed me from all my fears. Those who look to him for help will be radiant with joy. No shadow of shame will darken their faces. In my desperation, I prayed and the Lord listened. He saved me from all my troubles. For the angel of the Lord is a guard and he surrounds and defends all who fear him. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, the joys of those who take refuge in him. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Over in John 16, I have told you all of this so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows. We know that so well, but take heart because I have overcome the world. And finally, the last one, Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. Do not worry about anything. Maybe you've heard that before. Do not worry about anything, but instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all that he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything that we can understand. His peace will guard our hearts and minds as we live in Christ Jesus. So welcome again. I'm going to ask you to stand for our opening prayer. Good to see each and every one of you here. We're raising our hands to our Lord in reverence to him. And let's pray together. Father God, we love you. We love you, Lord. We are not worthy of your love, but we only love because you loved us first. What a great feeling it is to be in your house this morning. Many of us have fought through many difficulties and strains to get here, but yet you've prodded us to be here, dear God. We pray that right now in the stillness of these moments, we will prepare our heart, minds, bodies, and souls to be at one with you in a spirit of worship, calming down, giving everything to you, resting in the assurance that you are there for us through all things. And as we find ourselves in a spirit of worship, we will enjoy our time together with God's people here in this place. We will feel the Holy Spirit all around us. We will feel the tugging upon our own lives to straighten things out, to draw closer to you. And through that drawing, may we lead someone else to know you as Savior. Lord, I pray today, if there's someone here who does not know you, that today can be their day of salvation, that we would all rejoice with them together. We give our time unto you. We ask that you would work mightily as only you can. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please.
Happen is that everybody's going to get a quarter. Wow. There's your quarter. There's your quarter. There's your quarter. There's your quarter. Yep. There you go. There's your quarter. There's your quarter. There's your quarter. And Papa doesn't get one. Oh, why candy. Not? Papa, you can have a quarter. Why not? Now, I want to read to you in the Bible over in Luke 15 about a lady. And it says that a woman, she had 10 silver coins and she lost one. Does she not? What does she do? Well, it was night. So she lit a candle, a lamp, and she starts searching all over the place for the coin. And guess what? She found it. And then she called all her neighbors in, and they had a party. And you know, and they were rejoicing. And they say, that's the way it is in heaven when one person says that they're sorry and God forgives them. Well, I'm going to do something here. I'm going to ask you, you're going to get your quarter back, but put your quarter into bucket. Put your quarter into bucket. He's wanting to take the other one out. Says, oh, here we go. There we go. Put your quarter in the bucket. Oops. There, put your quarter. Oh, my.
Mercy.
I'm always making mistakes. Everybody pick up at least one quarter. Not yet. Everybody pick up a quarter. Here you go, sweetheart. Okay. Yeah, no, I'm not going to bite you. There's your quarter. Okay. I made a mistake. I'm always making mistakes. And I tell you, sometimes when I make a mistake and lose something, I can't find it again. But you know what I did? When I first came in that door this Sunday morning, I made another mistake. I had a 50-cent piece, and I was throwing it up in the air and catching it, and I lost it. It's between somewhere, I know, between this rope and this piece of paper. Can you help me find it? Someone go get it. Oh, you helped me find it. Thank you, sweetheart. Oh, but now we threw it again. Okay. But, you know, that's the way. I was sad when I lost my 50-cent piece, but now I'm happy because you helped me find it. And the thing is this, you know, we all make mistakes. Do you ever make a mistake? Yep. Do you make a mistake? Yep. I make a lot of mistakes. Yes. But the thing is, you know, when my mom and dad, when I made a mistake and I said, I'm sorry, they would always say, that's all right, sweetheart. And they would give me a big hug. And that's exactly what God wants to do when you say you're sorry to him. You know, mom and dad sometimes hug you and say, it's all right. Well, God wants to forgive you also for the things that you do. And the only thing you have to do is say, I'm sorry. Can we thank God for his forgiveness? Okay. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your forgiveness. And Lord, sometimes we do make mistakes. We lose things. And Lord, we just are sad about that. We're happy when we find them. But, Heavenly Father, we're happy also when we find that you will forgive us and when we say, I'm sorry. Just like mom and dad hugs us, you want to hug us, and, Lord, you want to be with us. And, Lord, we only have to say, Lord, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay? All right.
All right. Thank you so much for the wonderful music. We have so many talented folks here, folks that go out of their way to do a lot of things for our church, whether it be the cleaning or those on the security staff, keeping us safe, those guys back here in the sound booth, as well as many others of you giving your time, your talents, your abilities to the Lord. I'm going to ask before we show these clips that we'll turn these lights down because I want you to be able to see them with me. So what has been the great topic the last couple of weeks that we've all been talking about? Not at church specifically, but what's the big topic? War and what's going up and up and up and up and up. Gas prices. So this first picture up here is from last year. You see them prices? Man, I'd like to see them again, wouldn't you? The next one is from a couple of weeks ago. I don't know where that's from. That other one was local. Somebody in the church took the old one. So this is up and up and up. And then we got another one. Maybe what it was last week. You know, used to a diesel fuel was a byproduct of the whole process of making gas, and diesel fuel was cheaper, but supply and demand has made diesel fuel more and more and more expensive. But then I've got one last one that I really want you to pay attention to. You see that? Someone went to that pump. They pumped just over a gallon. They only had $5. $5 of gas is not going to get them very far. What do you think of when you see that? You know, the hot topic has been these prices, the war, what's it going to do to other things? None of us are happy with it. It seems that maybe it's only going to get worse in the very near future. The higher prices lead to increased commerce and shipping expenses, which in turn leads to all things that we use going higher, groceries and our medicines, our utilities. The list goes on and on and on. It all goes hand in hand with each other, and you say, oh, man, my anxiety level was already through the roof with what's going on, and now this on top of that. But what about that last picture? I saw a simple but very encouraging post this week, and here's what it said. So today I stopped and filled up my car, and I was thankful. Thankful that I have a car. Thankful that I have money to buy gas. Thankful that there are no warplanes flying over me. Thankful that I will be eating soon. Thankful that all my loved ones are safe and sound. Thankful that I live in a country where I have the freedom to do so many things. Thankful that the air I breathe is not filled with smoke and gunpowder. Thankful that I will sleep in silence and wake up to another beautiful day. I think it's time that we all be a lot more thankful and definitely more grateful. It's easy to complain, you know. If you pulled up to the pump tomorrow and you filled up, you had pulled up there with intentions of filling up, you're probably going to fill up no matter what it costs because you got places to go, things to do. All those things of your day have got to happen. But if you pull up there and you see that last picture that the person before you only got $5 worth, would that not bring you kind of down a notch and say, praise God, I didn't have to stop at $5? I think that's the way we should approach life, even in the midst of hard times. And yes, maybe we do need to cut back. Maybe we do need to slow down. Maybe we need to sort of line up our trips so we can check off several things at once and not go back and forth like we have gotten accustomed to doing. Make a little planning involved. I think if we did that, not only would we be better stewards of what God has given us, we could probably use a lot less gas than we use. We've got accustomed to just going and doing exactly what we want to. With that in mind, we're going to start our time together today. This filling station of encouragement should be right here. Each and every time we come here, and we're going to start our time together by looking in Hebrews chapter 10. And once you find it, I'm going to ask you to stand with me in the reading of these first few verses that we'll find in Hebrews chapter 10, beginning in verse 19. This is a call to persevere. Hebrews 10, beginning in verse 19, it says, "So, dear brothers and sisters, we can boldly enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. By his death, Jesus opened a new and life-giving way through the curtain into the most holy place. And since we have a great high priest who rules over God's house, let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting him. For our guilty consciences have been sprinkled with Christ's blood to make us clean, and our bodies have been washed with pure water. Let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope that we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep his promise. Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works, and let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near." And then flip over to chapter 11, just three short verses. We talked about these Wednesday night in the men's ministry meeting, and I felt it was extremely important to include them with us right here. Chapter 11 is filled full of heroes of the faith. But chapter 11 does not come without chapter 10. Those heroes were encouraged. They had examples to feed upon and be fueled with. Chapter 11, verse 1, "Faith shows the reality of what we hope for it is the evidence of things we cannot see. Through their faith, the people in days of old earned a good reputation, and by faith we understand that the entire universe was formed at God's command, that what we now see did not come from anything that can be seen." You may be seated. Let me read that verse 3 again. "For by faith we understand that the entire universe was formed at God's command, and what we now see did not come from anything that can't be seen." Meaning we rely, everything that we believe today relies upon our faith, that we are faithful, that all that we're told about that happened before happened in accordance to God's will, and it did occur. We don't question it. Sometimes we may in our mind, we can't explain it, but yet as a Christian, we're faithful enough to know that it occurred the way that God said it occurred, right? None of us are here today because we just thought we would go out to church and just make a showing and we just needed to be there for whatever reason. No, we came to hopefully get something out of it. And hopefully not only get encouragement, but be encouragement. You know, all through God's Word, especially in the Old Testament, we read of sacrifices. Sacrifices to rid the sinners and the wrongdoers of their sin. And it's said throughout the Bible that there are absolutely no remission of sins without some sort of shedding of blood. Now, isn't it wonderful that we don't have to share the shed blood to have our sins atoned for any longer? God did all that by sending his son, Jesus. He laid his life down. His blood was shed once and for all on the cross. Man, I sure would have to think or hate to think that I would have to bring a sacrifice for every time that I sinned. Before long, I'd have no animals left. But praise God, we don't have to go through that. But as faithful Christians, we put our faith in the shed blood of Jesus one time, and then that covers it all. It's just like a blanket a blanket that was totally red, but yet when Jesus came, he washed it white as snow. Jesus' death on the cross so many years ago is unequivocally the spiritual blanket that covers our sins. It covers the sins that we had in our past, the ones that we will commit today, and any that we commit in the future. But that doesn't happen until we put our faith in him. I don't know about you, but there was times in my life that I sort of played and toyed around with that idea of really knowing Christ. Yes, I wanted him in my life, but maybe I didn't want to give up those things that I enjoyed, but yet I knew they were wrong. Maybe you're at that point. Maybe you're wondering, how do I make this right? Because he rose again and sits at the right hand of the Father in heaven, we are completely relieved of the need for any sacrifices. And because, according to the word, God can be trusted to keep his promises, we know that we have been forgiven and saved. We should be motivated, according to what we just read in chapter 10 of Hebrews, be motivated to encourage others. Well, preacher, I'm just too busy. I got this to do and I got that. I have to be here by this time. I got to pick up kids by this time. We got to be to this ball game and to this recital and to that. But you know, during that time, you're coming in contact and you're intermingling with people all the time. The smile upon your face, the encouragement in your heart, something nice that you say should not go unnoticed. Don't wall yourself up in a shell where no one knows that you love Jesus. As we read through those verses, do you think of yourself as an encourager? Reverend Billy Graham said it this way, sometimes we encourage someone without being aware of it. Even the examples that we set by attending church may encourage someone who is searching for God. As Christian believers, if you still have your Bibles open to Hebrews chapter 10, look back with me at 22, 23, and 24. And if we went back and looked at these in the King James Version, verse 22 says, let us draw near, meaning go right into the presence of God, drawing near. Verse 23 says, let us hold fast, hold tight to the hope and the trustworthiness of our God. And finally, in 24, let us consider one another. Think of ways to motivate one another to do acts of kindness. Every once in a while, we hear somebody talking about random acts of kindness. Well, your random acts may be totally different than the person sitting beside of you. Some of you ladies, you cook up great things and you take them to families in need or those that have lost loved ones. Many others, you reach out and you send a wonderful text telling somebody how much you care for them and that you're praying for them. Others of you, and I know some of you men sitting in here, that you do anything that you possibly could for somebody else when you've got time to do it, but yet you don't want any credit. I know who you are. I see how you work. Let me tell you, that is contagious. And we're watching you because you are our godly and spiritual examples. You see, we see what God's doing through you, and that encourages us. On our worst days, we're encouraged by someone who's close to God. And then hopefully, the next time, on someone else's worst day, they're encouraged through something we may do. The Bible teaches us to be more concerned about the needs and feelings of others than the concerns of our own selves. We are to encourage and build self-confidence in our loved ones, friends, and associates. Dr. Graham said that also. Turn with me to 2 Timothy chapter 3. And while you're turning there, the finished work of our Savior on the cross should never grow dull or dim. It should be in our mind's eye every single day. And it allows us to have a deep and personal relationship with Him. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. You should know this, Timothy, that in the last days there will be very difficult times. For people will love themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, and ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. Stay away from people like that. Pride. Pride. What is pride? And how do we get rid of pride? I'll tell you how you get rid of pride. When you think that you're on top of the world and everything is going great and you're never going to have any problems, what usually happens? The wool's pulled right out from under you. Down you go. You got a struggle. You got a problem. You got an issue. You got financial problems. You got sickness. You got a problem with a relationship. Just when you thought it was going good, man, I'm doing great. I'm making all the right decisions. I'm making good money. Boom. God brings you down to earth. I raised chickens for almost 26 years. You know, I thought I knew what to do each time. You try to do a good job. You do the same things over and over and over and over each time because you don't want to leave any steps out. But then one flock did great. The next flock did terrible. You're thinking, why? Well, a good friend of mine told me that that's the way God keeps you from being prideful. He points that you're dependent upon Him, not on what you're doing. If you could click it off and do it exactly the same way every time and finish on top, everybody could do that. And then you would forget where the blessings come from. That's what my friend said. Look to God, not to self. We talked about that last week. And these are the dangers of the last days, dangers that we are living in now in this present time. Pride is at the center of it all. Don't let pride dominate your lives. All through the scripture, it says the proud are always in defense of the wrong in which they are associated. For some reason, guilt and remorse is not even in their vocabulary any longer. Pride breeds arrogance, and God hates a prideful heart. Proverbs 16:18, pride goes before destruction and haughtiness before the fall. I pray that we would guard our hearts against deceitful pride. One more verse of scripture as we move to conclusion. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. And this is totally a mouthful. Don't copy the behaviors and customs of this world. That means don't conform to this world. But let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Don't conform to this world, but be transformed into a renewing of your minds. Giving all, trusting in all that Jesus has to offer, and encouraging others daily by the lives that we live. The old saying that our lives are defined by 10% of what happens to us and 90% of how we handle what happens to us is so, so true. I put a message out a couple of weeks ago, I think it was last Saturday, that we make the decisions of what we're going to do later that day and the next day long in advance. Sometimes it's an hour or two, sometimes it's a day or two, sometimes it's a week or two, other times it's a month or two. Well, let me just tell you, right now, you're here this morning because you decided yesterday or sometime last week that you were going to be here. There's very few of you that decided at 10 o'clock that you're going to come at 11. It doesn't work that way. You see, God impresses upon your heart that He wants you to be where He wants you to be. And you can fight him tooth and nail, but until you give in and surrender, he's not going to use you to be encouragers for others because our hearts are not pure. You know, we come here expecting a blessing, yes, but the whole idea of rendering an encouraging blessing to someone else is really the reason that we're here. Forsake not yourselves. If we went back to the Old Testament, those first scripture verses from Hebrews 10, forsake not the assembling together of yourselves. I remember when, and I don't want to bring up bad memories for Miss Jennifer, but I remember the day that David was going through his surgery. That was really the first time that I got to know you guys very well. And I saw a friend of mine up there. And for some reason, Mark was there, Steve Howard was there, and others, I think Skip was even there. And we were talking to this guy that I had known in the past, and he began to bring up memories of church because he knew that we were all from church. And he began to share the Bible verses that he learned as a child. And one of them was from Hebrews chapter 10, forsake not the assembling of ourselves together as some would, but yet believing and relying on Christ that by that assembling, not only are we uplifted, but we uplift each other. That was a sweet time, even though it was in the midst of a tough time. Because every person in that waiting room was going through something, some trial, some sickness, some issue, some surgery, but yet God was uplifted right there that day. And by the way, there was a few good stories that Harold told about driving cars fast and working for Texas Rangers and police departments and all them. And this guy knew all that too, because somehow or another he was intertwined with that too. So we had just a great good visit. But you know, you all are Christian role models. And this morning, as we prepare to leave this filling station, it costs you something to be here. You say, well, what do you mean by that? Well, I mean, there's other things that you could have been doing this morning. It cost you something to decide that you were going to come. It cost you something to be engaged in the Word. It cost you something to listen to me blabber. It cost you something to be all in to what God has for your life. I pray that it's not just a time that we check it off, that we got through that one, that we made it. And by the way, isn't it wonderful to hear the cries of our little babies again and our little ones here? Isn't it great to see people stumbling and rumbling and trying to get here just at the last minute? It happens. It's okay. Because we come assembling together to get a blessing and give a blessing. But we come to communicate the knowledge and the love of Jesus to every single person that we come in contact with. So this is not the ending point for your week. This is the beginning point. This is the preparation time that when you leave here and go out, that you bless someone else. Here's a poem by J. Vernon McGee in our closing. J. Vernon McGee has long been passed away, and he has, through the Bible radio, each and every day at 12:30 on 93.5, and then you can look him up on Facebook and on different places of media. And his messages about the Word, they call it the Bible Bus, is still out there every single day. And there's so many followers. Well, I was listening to him one day this week, and he shared this poem. There's a green hill far away without a city wall, where the dear Lord was crucified, who died to save us all. There was no other good enough to pay the price of sin. He could only unlock the gate of heaven and let us in. What part of the world are you going to make a difference for Christ? We know what Reverend Billy Graham has done for our world. That wouldn't have occurred if he hadn't been tuned into Christ, close to Christ. And then for years, his son Franklin, they referred to him as being the rebellious Christian. But now look what God is doing through him. And that is a slogan of his. What part of the world are you going to touch for Christ? What are you going to do for Christ that will make the world a better place, a different place, a more encouraging place? You see, it's easy for us to complain. It's easy for us to find fault. It's hard to shell out the wallet and get those credit cards out and stick it in that tank, knowing that it may not even stop at 100. But you know what? God's blessing us. God's concerned with what we're concerned with. Be an encourager in that time. Find the blessings in it. I promise you, your days will be better. With a smile upon your face, you'd be surprised how many people you can encourage. I'm going to ask our musicians to come. I'm going to ask you to stand. In closing this morning, our question is what part of the world can you touch and change for Christ? Let's pray together before our invitation. Lord, we thank you for our time here today. We thank you that you are a constant encourager. Lord, without you, we would be nothing. We could do nothing. We could have nothing. We could experience nothing. It's all through your provisions that we're even here today. I pray that something that is said or a song that we've sang or a smile that someone has rendered unto us or a good word or a voice of love has encouraged us today, and that we will take that encouragement to a really tough world this week, Lord. As we leave out of here, we should have a big sign out at the front door that said, "Entering the mission field." Because we are all missionaries. Lord, I pray that if there's one here who does not know you as Savior, if there's those here that need a renewing of their spirit, that they would use this altar, that they would come, Lord. But that can only be done because of you. Pray this morning that we will be less in tune of complaining and more in tune of encouraging. And that you will work mightily, and we will give you praise, honor, glory, day in and day out, even in the struggles and trials. So you have your way in our invitation time, Lord. You work as only you can. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. You come as the Lord leads. The altar is always open. You come and lay down your concerns and prayers.